Well, hello there. We just want you to know that the views expressed on this broadcast of Open Forum do not necessarily reflect the views of any 12-step fellowship that would meet at my North Pole, or any other place for that matter. This radio station claims no affiliation with any of those 12-step fellowships. So don't get your Christmas tree lights all in a tangled bunch. Now hear those jolly recovery ragamuffins. Your Royal Highness, Eve D., the Prince of Big Bookology, Bruce H., and our court, pathetic court jester, Mr. Montgomery, the man.
Well, welcome, everyone. This is going to be really weird. Welcome to our Christmas special here at Take12Radio.com.
That's really weird, isn't it? A Christmas special.
On your internet dial. That's right. It is a very special Christmas special. I'm holding my, for those of you who are viewing on YouTube, I'm holding my headset to my ear because if I don't, that's what happens. It just kind of hangs there. Welcome. We had intended on having a studio full of people. We're not sure what happened to them. They got lost or something. But I'll tell you who is here. Is Eve and Bruce, of course, are here. And Wado is here. Hi, Wado.
And I want you people on YouTube to look and wonder what would happen if anybody else would have showed up.
Yeah, they could tell us how Santa mugged them, I guess.
They'd been hanging from the lights.
That's right. Well, Wado, for those of you who don't know, you've heard his voice on many of our disclaimers. Now you see his face. Wave to the camera, Wado. That's Wade Coffey, and you see his name go by at the end of the show when it says disclaimer. It has a little rolling credits there, and. So that's Wade Coffey. Wade was with us years ago when we did Coffee with the Coffees. And how long did we do that show?
We did it for approximately 3.5 years.
3.5 years.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. It was like, and that is where this show actually was inspired from, Open Forum. So welcome, everybody. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
And we're going to have some fun today. If I can keep this thing on my head. I may just take it off here in a minute. But anyway.
I got some super glue.
You got some super glue?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's really Gorilla.
Gorilla glue? That sounds great.
You know it is.
Is it like super glue?
Oh, man.
Oh, Gorilla glue? It's got a grip.
Boy. Well, Wado, he's in for a treat because Wado has never met Cecil.
Mm.
And Cecil lives in the computer, and Cecil's going to come out and play here in a minute. Cecil, are you there, Cecil?
Yes, I'm here, Monty Man, and I have something special that I put together.
Cool.
Because I thought, you know, with how crazy the world is today, we have to make sure that we are all very politically correct.
Yeah.
So I have this poem. May I read this poem?
You may read the poem, Cecil. Go right
oh,
ahead.
Oh, good. Here goes. 'Twas the night before Christmas, and Santa's a wreck. How to live in a world that's politically correct? His workers no longer would answer to elves. Vertically challenged, they were calling themselves. And labor conditions at the North Pole were alleged by the union to stifle the soul. 4 reindeer had vanished without much propriety, released to the wilds by the Humane Society. And equal employment had made it quite clear that Santa had better not use just reindeer. So Dancer and Donner, Comet, and Cupid were replaced with four pigs. Now, you know, that looks stupid. The runners had been removed from the sleigh. The ruts were termed dangerous by the EPA. And people had started to call for the cops when they heard sled noises on their rooftops. Secondhand smoke from his pipe had his workers quite frightened. His fur-trimmed red suit was called unenlightened. And to show you the strangeness of life's ebbs and flows, Rudolph was suing over unauthorized use of his nose and had gone on Dr. Phil in front of the nation, demanding millions in overdue compensation. So half of the reindeer were gone, and his wife, who suddenly said she'd had enough of this life. She joined a 12-step group, packed, and left in a whiz, demanding from now on her title was Ms. And as for the gifts, well, he'd never had a notion that making a choice could cause such commotion. Nothing of leather, nothing of fur, which meant nothing for him and nothing for her. Nothing that might be construed to pollute, nothing to aim, nothing to shoot. Nothing that clamored or made lots of noise. Nothing for just girls or just for the boys. Nothing that claimed to be gender specific. Nothing that's warlike or non-pacific. No candy or sweets. They were bad for the tooth. Nothing that seemed embellished a truth. And fairy tales, well, not yet forbidden, were like Ken and Barbie, better off hidden. For they raised and hackled of those psychological who claimed the only good gift was one ecological. No baseball, no football, someone could get hurt. Besides, playing sports exposed kids to dirt. Dolls were said to be sexist and should be passé. An Xbox would rot your entire brain away. So Santa just stood there, disheveled, perplexed. He just could not figure out what to do next. Something special was needed, a gift that he might give to all without angering the left or the right. A gift that would satisfy with no indecision each group of people, every religion, every ethnicity, every you, everyone everywhere. Yes, even you. So here is that gift. It's priced beyond worth. May you and your loved ones enjoy peace on earth. Merry Christmas, Monty Man. Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas,
Merry
Cecil.
Christmas, Cecil.
With the advent of the Affordable Care Act and existing parity legislation, addictions or severe substance use disorders will be considered as other chronic health conditions. Treatment outcomes will be newly defined and closely watched. Reimbursement models will also shift to motivate changes in efficiency and effectiveness of care provided. There are many new and exciting challenges coming down the pipe, and we all must be ready. Well, C4 Recovery Solutions is hosting ACCESS, Addiction Executives Industry Summit, as a working conference for board members, senior executives, medical directors, clinical supervisors, mid-level managers, and information technology staff to plan for and implement strategies to meet these challenges. The Addiction Executives Industry Summit will be held at the breathtaking Waldorf Astoria in Naples, Florida, February 9th through the 12th, 2014. For more information and to register, visit www.accesssummit.com. That's AccessSummit.com. And join us for one of the most informative conferences you'll attend all year.
Origins Recovery Centers provides integrated inpatient treatment for substance abuse and co-occurring disorders. At Origins, clients receive expert medical, clinical, and spiritual care individually designed for their needs. Our clients leave Origins with the foundation upon which they will build the rest of their lives. Call now to speak with an admissions specialist. Our toll-free number is 888-843-8935. That's 888-843-8935. Origins, delivering real solutions for real families.
Oh, it's that time again for Take 12 Trivia. You guys ready? All right, Cecil.
It's time for Take 12 Trivia with a Christmas theme. All questions will be confusing and just a little bit mean because we know you're not as smart as you look. We took the answers right out of a book. So be prepared for the Monty Man's tricks. And if you get them all right, well, oh, fiddlesticks.
All right. Take 12 Trivia, crazy. Whether you get it. Really? Okay, whether you get the answers right or wrong, you'll hear some crazy sound like that. All right, Christmas Trivia, wrapping it up for December. And before we do this, I just want to let folks know that if you're listening, you're not watching on YouTube, we do have Tim Cook's...
I want to fess up that I asked Cecil for the answers because I wanted to give them right. So
did you peek?
You're not listening to me. I'm trying to fess up.
I'll take your confession momentarily.
Still waiting on an email from Cecil.
Tim Cook's candle is lit for those of you watching on YouTube. The reason we have this electric candle here is in memory of Tim Cook, who passed away this month sober at City Team in Oakland, California. He was working on his recovery and working with others in recovery, and we dedicated Open Forum Wednesday every show this month to the memory of Tim. And Bruce, if you peeked and looked at the answers, you're going to get coal in your stocking.
I talked to Cecil.
You did?
Yes. So I'm not sure, but I think Cecil.
I'm going to have a little chat with Cecil. Cecil's giving away the answers. All right, here we go. Christmas trivia, the last one for 2013. Not the last trivia, though. Sorry. Okay, number one.
See, I told you.
I knew he was doing it to me.
The name of Scrooge's deceased business partner in Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol was, and here are your three choices, Bob Marley.
Yaman. Yaman.
I hallucinate, too.
Rasta Claus.
Jason Marley or Jacob Marley?
Jacob Marley.
Bruce?
Jacob Marley.
Wade?
I'm going to go with Rasta Claus.
You like Bob?
Man, I like Bob Marley, man.
Well, actually, was Bob right? Disguised as Jacob. He yeah, was Jacob Marley. That is the creator. Okay, question number two. What did Frosty the Snowman have for a nose? A carrot. B, a button, or C, a lump of coal.
Lump of coal, wasn't it?
Okay, who is singing the song in their head right now to figure it out?
I know, right? What do you think, Eve?
A carrot.
A carrot, a button, or a lump of coal?
He wasn't a carrot. Well, we've got it all covered, don't we? Okay, which one of us is right?
What did you say, Wade?
I said button.
You said a button. What did you say?
I said coal.
You said coal? Well, Wade is correct. It was a button.
Oh, that's not fair.
With
that's
a
that.
Top pipe and a button nose and two eyes made out of coal.
That's right.
He did not have a mouth.
You got to remember, he's the music guy.
Oh, the coal was there then.
Two eyes.
Two eyes made out of coal. Yeah. Okay, number three. In the movie.
I would like to change my answer.
I'm thinking you should not trust Cecil anymore. To give
That's
you
what
the
I know.
I knew that.
See what happens when you go behind the Iron Curtain and talk to Cecil? Okay, number three. In the movie Miracle on 34th Street, a man is on trial for claiming to be Santa Claus. What branch of the government convinces the judge to rule in the man's favor? Here are your choices. The Congress, the Postal Service, or the Department of Treasury?
Postal
Service. The Postal Service.
Yes, Wade.
It was Homeland Security. No, wait a minute. They were prosecuting. It had to be,
the Postal Service.
The Postal Service is correct, because they did what? What'd they do, you guys? You remember what they did?
Yes, well, they brought in all the letters.
Every piece of mail for Santa Claus, Kris Kringle, et al. And put it on the judge's bench.
They sure did.
Yeah, bags and bags.
Such a great movie.
We've all seen it 3,674 times.
And we'll probably see it again. Okay, here's your bonus question. This one may be a little difficult. I don't know. Or maybe easy. In the TV show, A Charlie Brown Christmas.
In the TV show, Charlie Brown Christmas.
Yes. Lucy was kissed once during the entire show.
Yes, she was.
Who kissed her? Here are your choices. Schroeder. He's the little guy who plays piano. Charlie Brown or Snoopy.
Snoopy.
It was Snoop Dogg.
It was. I've been kissed by a dog. And she said,
Snoop Dogg. Who said Snoop Dogg? Did you say Snoop Dogg?
Nobody had to give Snoopy, Lucy shots or anything like that,
No.
I mean, we could go out on a limb here. You can edit this if you want. But, I mean, she may have given him crap. She was so crabby.
Oh, Lord, have mercy.
Yeah. I think he was merciful because of Linus.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, now, Linus was her brother, correct?
Yeah, that's all right.
Yeah, I almost put Linus as a choice. That'd have been a little weird.
Yeah, but he knew what Christmas was all about.
Linus did.
Yes,
and we're going to talk about that here before the show's over with Charlie Brown. all right. Well, very good, guys. Very good. That will do it for our last trivia of 2013. All right.
You got 4 out of 4, Eve.
Yeah, I was on a roll.
She was on a roll.
Was it a Kaiser roll or an
It was a lettuce roll. I don't eat any carbs.
Okay, so...
Those are bakeries.
Well, what I want to do before we get any further is everybody gets a present. You can pick. It doesn't mean they're all the same just because they're in the same box.
Okay.
But they are.
Okay, now the people that didn't show up, can we have one of theirs too?
You can have one of theirs too and give it away as a Christmas present if you like.
Oh, hey, that's like really cool. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, you can do that. So take two. They're small.
Okay.
Seriously, and it's already wrapped for you, so you don't have to wrap it. You can give it to somebody, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. You don't want to know what it is?
Yes.
Going back to Snoop Dogg when you talk about wrapping?
Oh, Lord. You're reaching, buddy.
Cecil told me.
What did Cecil say?
Candy.
Oh.
Cecil's wrong. Cecil lied.
Cecil lied. Imagine.
Well, we have every year I put together a CD of recovery music from recovery recording artists.
Oh, right.
The best one, the one that got the most response, was in 2011. So I re-recorded it, put it together for you guys, and this is the 2011.
That's wonderful.
There's 18 songs by 18 recovery recording artists, including Joe Walsh and some other people, all of which, other than Joe Walsh, have been on our show. And so that's for you guys to enjoy. You can play it in any CD player. And now you know what it is, so you can give it to somebody that you think mm-hmm. would enjoy that. Mm-hmm. And there's some funny songs in there. There's a couple of serious songs in there, but they're really good. Mm. They're really, really good.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Monty.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
wonderful.
You bet. Okay, so the topic. You know, there's so many things that we could talk about around this time of year, and we've covered some of the things. One of the things that we've kind of honed in on is how difficult it can be for some people in recovery during the holidays. And last week we talked about how difficult it is for those people that we've affected during the holidays. We know that addiction and alcoholism is the number one health issue in our nation. Number one, it supersedes everything because it afflicts and affects more people than any other. And yet it gets the least amount of attention, the recovery side of it does, because of the stigma. We hope that's getting better. It kind of rises to the top, then it kind of drops a little bit, and then again. But I think it's getting better slowly but surely. I think people are talking about it more. I think, and not to toot my own horn at all, because there are other people doing this. But I think because of recovery media, I think people are starting to understand that anonymity does not mean secrecy. That it is our public relations policy that's based on attraction rather than promotion, not our personal stories. And that it's okay in most 12-step circles to openly share your personal story as long as you don't identify yourself as representing that particular 12-step fellowship or if you're a member of it, you know. But we've been kind of afraid to talk about it because people have gotten, you know, people gotten yelled at, people gotten told, yeah, you can't do that, and that kind of thing.
Well, that's why I invented the phrase 12-stepology.
Yeah.
That is not directly connected to any particular anonymous group. It is directly connected to the 12 steps,
right.
Period, which
right.
is what we need to recover from all of our obsessive compulsive problems.
Right.
So.
Good point. And when you did it years ago, Wado kind of coined that phrase on the Coffee with the Coffee show, because here's the deal. The reason there's not enough evidence out there that this thing works is because we've kept our mouths shut. We've hidden in the basements of our churches and meeting halls and things like that. But so it's time to open up our mouth and talk about the steps and talk about how that when applied and implemented into our lives and the principles, the spiritual principles in those 12 steps, when effectively applied, it changes our lives. And we become better people. We become not just clean and or sober. We become different people because of this wonderful power greater than ourselves that restores us to sanity, not sobriety, sanity. Lots of people can get sober.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. but we've
That's
all
true.
Done it. So what I wanted to talk about this week was what is different in your lives this Christmas? Now, you know, some of us have been around the tables and have been sober through several Christmases and that kind of thing. Some not so much in the rooms. But is there something different about this time of year for you as somebody who is in recovery or is a recovered alcoholic or addict? Is there something different going on with you than was the same time last year? Do you have different goals? Do you have different an outlook on things a little differently? Has tragedy struck and changed you in one way or the other? What's been going on this year with you guys? And what is Christmas time, i.e. the holidays, bring to your mind, your heart, and your spirit this year in 2013? We'll start with Eve.
Oh, I was hoping to get a few moments to think.
Okay, you can if you want to.
It's okay. I mean, not a lot has. There's only one major thing that has changed in the last year, and that is my mom lives with me now.
Right.
And I thank you, Wade. And she moved in with me in April. She's had a couple of strokes. So she moved from Florida. I went to go get her and moved her in. And it's been the most wonderful experience. And I'm just so grateful. Not a day goes by that I'm not just incredibly aware of my gratitude for her being there and for having this opportunity with her. And last year is very similar to this year, except that this year, for the first time in quite a few years, because I have four children and they all have partners, everybody's going to be here this year, and that hasn't happened for probably almost 10 years where everybody's been there.
Wow.
And so there's going to be 10 people in the house, all my kids, their partners, and my mom and I, and I am absolutely thrilled, and I'm planning to get a family portrait done while everybody's there. I've got my tripod and my camera, and I'm really looking forward to that almost, yeah. You know, more than anything else on Christmas.
A little holiday drama.
No, there probably won't be much drama. So, yeah, it's a very good year. I graduated day before yesterday with my bachelor's degree, so that part of my life is...
From George Fox.
From George Fox.
Yeah.
I start grad school in January, but this 3 weeks time is just really nice to just not have any homework to do.
Right.
Writing to do, and just kick back and relax with my family and enjoy the time. So.
So you got a bachelor's in...
In behavioral and social sciences.
So now she knows how to behave and be social.
Yeah. And it was work, let me tell you. Well, that's probably pretty true right there, Monty.
Really? Well, you know, congratulations. And when I saw your picture on Facebook, I just got goosebumps. It just awesome. Yeah. And that's one of the things that many people do, right? Once they get clean and sober and are restored to sanity, some of them go back to school and get their degrees. And yeah, what an awesome gift.
Yes, it is.
Did it feel really great to do this thing with the tassel?
Yeah, that was pretty good. Yeah.
Did you throw your hat in the air?
No.
No. They don't let you do that anymore, do they?
I didn't see anybody throwing any hats.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah. They don't want you getting poked in the eye, I guess.
Well, yeah, it's dangerous.
Yeah, they might get
hurt. That's not politically correct. You have Cecil up in arms.
You know, I kept my hat in high school because I didn't want to lose it. But I lost it.
Oh.
So I should have just thrown it. So that's, what a great thing. Your mom's with you. That's a great story. Good stuff. Wado, what about you, buddy? What's is there anything different this year? Any area
anything
that you've
different?
Grown
well,
or matured? Or,
I have
or,
absolutely no plans.
You have no plans.
I have no plans.
Last year was different. You had plans.
Well, things have changed a bit drastically since the last Coffee with the Coffee show. I am no longer married. I no longer live with my kids. So we haven't made plans yet. I'd have to say, you know, to talking about inspirational stories, I guess. I haven't seen my sister for a good 15 years. And just recently, in the last 3 weeks or so, she called my mom.
Wow.
And was needing help. And I, you know, when something happens and you feel compelled to do something and you know it's God telling you, go here now. Well, I drove down. I borrowed my stepdad's truck, and I drove down to Vallejo, California. Yes, I was in the Bay Area, and I didn't let anyone know.
Sometimes you can't let anybody know because they all want you to come see them, right?
I didn't want anybody trying to find me where I was. Okay, I mean, like gangland USA. But I know I went and I spent the week with her, packing up stuff, loading up a truck, and then I drove her back up here to Oregon to be with her boys. Who live in Portland, and just recently, this last week, I had her at my place for a week, and we spent time, how can I say this? She was in recovery. She walked out of recovery, and because of where she was when I went down there, I feel that God has let us take our particular paths, and has drawn us back together to this one point so that I could lead her back into some serious healing.
Wow.
You know, and it's not me that's doing the work. It's God working through me, so I get to be the messenger.
Mm-hmm.
And if anything happens through these holidays, you know, through Christmas and all that, her getting back into recovery is probably going to be the biggest blessing that I could think of right now.
Wow.
And just being there, to be there and to say the things that I've said to her, and to listen to her and to validate her and to confirm that, yes, you are valued as a human being. Yes, I think of you as a family member always. Because there's a whole convoluted history and past that I choose not to get into right now. Sure. Because it would just a whole another 12 radio shows. But it's brought a brother and sister back together. It's brought a mother and daughter back together who had questions for decades about each other, and now this healing is an amazing thing, and that's basically why Jesus came to earth, was to heal the sick. And it lets me know that I may be healing, but I'm not healed yet, you know. Right. And it's good. It's very good. It's a good feeling.
What
to
a
know
great
that,
Christmas gift to yeah. know that. Yeah. Oh, wow. Pretty cool, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty cool. Cause you've had some very painful moments this year.
Oh, sure.
You know, with family issues and work, trying to get work.
Oh, yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I'm still looking for full-time work. I'm working on call at one place, and I'm waiting to hear from another place on the coast, which I'm really hoping for because I love the coast. And then there's another place that called me out of the blue and asked me if I wanted to do on-call work, and I'm like, well, sure, yeah.
Yeah. So, and tell the listeners what it is you do.
Oh, well, I am I'll spit out the big word, and then I'll explain what it is.
Yeah.
I'm a polysomnographic technologist.
Polysomnographic technologist.
Monty, you said it right the first time. Wow. we need like a joyous noise there or something, you know. Okay, but polysomnography is sleep studies. And you know, it's one thing I got to say, Bruce.
If you said that name, I would have never known that. Yeah. I just dropped it right there.
From the moment I first met you and heard you laugh in the rooms, that was a joyous sound to me.
It really is.
But that, and every time I watch, what is that? Finding Nemo.
Yeah.
And they had that little 12-step meeting.
Oh, Bruce.
Hey, Bruce. I always think of our brother Bruce here.
Bruce!
But,
So you do sleep studies.
Yes, I do sleep studies. What I do is I bring in very nervous patients, show up at the sleep lab. I calm them down. I hook up about 32 different data collecting sensors on them.
Paint
tell
their
them
faces.
To calm down.
Oh, all that stuff on?
Well, his face, head, effort belts around the torso, the abdomen, got some on the legs, EKG stuff.
And, yeah.
And there, you know, you have to tell them, okay, we're videotaping this, and there's a microphone in here, too, so we see and hear everything that goes on 24 hours. And
have a nice sleep.
Yeah, and that's it. Just for that, I could go to sleep.
With all that stuff.
Yeah, and you know what? They do.
Isn't that amazing?
They do. And, well, if you've been sleeping like these people have for as many years as they have and are as exhausted as they are,
right.
You go to sleep too. And what I do is I collect the data that these sensors receive
right.
on the computer, and I determine in the first 3 hours of the study whether they are having severe enough sleep apnea. And if it's severe enough, then I will go in, I'll wake them up, I'll put a CPAP mask on them, and
You'll
will treat them.
Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain.
That's like the nurse coming to wake me up. Take these.
Take these, I'll help you sleep.
You need them to sleep. Oh, gosh.
Well, yes, in essence, I do wake them up and tell them to go back to sleep.
Boggles the mind.
But no, in the process, with continuous positive airway pressure, which is what CPAP stands for, I can eliminate all the respiratory events and all the arousals right. that happen so that they just breathe while they're asleep and they, their sleep is not fragmented like it has yeah. been, and they get a good night's sleep.
Mm.
Find the right pressure for them so that they breathe all the time.
Right. And right.
Really what I've found over the year that I have been doing this is I have been given the opportunity to improve the quality of a person's life.
Yeah, that's so cool. It's there wonderful.
That is so cool, dude. Blessing.
I they put one of those CPAPs on me.
It's CPAP. CPAP.
CPAP. CPAP. Yeah. Yeah. And they put a CPAP.
And a pop. Pap. Come on, Pappy.
And he, I told him it was wonderful. He said, describe it. I said, I think I took a handful of pills. It was sure. so relaxing and so wonderful
hmm.
that you know, I could breathe.
Well, I tell you, and I live with sleep apnea, so does my son Cameron.
I didn't have sleep apnea.
And the very first time that went on my face, I felt like a million yeah. bucks the next day.
Wow.
Because I hadn't had yeah. that kind of sleep in so many years. And it's interesting because I'm due for another study. So is Cameron. So we're probably going to go in or close as we can together. But it's an amazing process.
Hmm.
And the first time I did it, I had a full beard. Not just a goatee. But
shave this time.
That yeah, was a
shave
little
your head, too. They will love you. Trust
oh, really?
Me, trust me. Oh, yeah. We love bald men.
It's so much easier.
Bald women are
how
good,
about
too.
Bald women?
So that's great, Wado. In case anybody is interested, Wado is available for full time work, right?
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
In the state of Oregon, I am also fully. I am registered with the BRPT, and I am licensed with the state of Oregon to practice polysomnography.
There you go.
So,
say hey, it again.
I'm up for it.
Polly, my cracker.
If you're down for it, I'm up for it.
Well, Bruce, how about Bruce? You know, what is this holiday time, particularly Christmas, what is different this year than last year?
Hmm. Well, I've had some major health issues, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I've spent a lot of time drawing closer to the Lord, trying to adjust and not let this get me down.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's taken its toll on me, and it's the recovery is slow. And isn't it wonderful that God, when we come to faith in a belief that we have something to tap into in these times, what would I do, Eve, if I didn't have that?
Mm-hmm.
I'd get depressed and just despondent and just, you know, so it's just a wonderful time for me to know that he's with me, and this is the time of year that we celebrate his coming and his birth, and I get to be with family, and I'm enjoying them more than I have before. My grandson's been, I missed all that when I was out there in my addiction, so he's mm-hmm. been a real blessing to me. And I got to go over there the other day, and for the first time in our relationship, he had two of his friends with him, and he didn't pay attention to me, and he ran off down the street, and I was thinking how wonderful.
Huh.
Wow. I'm getting a little emotional because it's like I'm experiencing those things for the first time.
Wow.
Yeah.
I can relate to that.
Yeah. And it's really remarkable. That's what recovery has done for me.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And many, many people are listening. We're praying for you, have been praying for you when you were in the hospital. We really thought that Eve, you had actually said goodbye.
I did.
To Bruce in the hospital while he was
I did.
Was unconscious.
Yeah, and yeah. He was in a coma.
Coma, yeah.
I
Tacoma?
And his
Tacoma?
His brain waves His brain waves were such that the doctors had not given much hope to the family. So, but it just goes to show you that the miracle of what happened.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That God did do a miracle because you don't have any brain damage at all.
Well,
no more than what was going on before.
I talked to Cecil and her crying out loud.
All right, so brain damage is in the eye of the beholder.
So Wade had a heart attack. You were in the hospital. Been in the hospital.
You had a heart attack.
Yeah, Wade had a heart attack.
Mm-hmm. Wow!
At the end of September. It was almost directly a month after I lost my job, and I was getting ready to go to a symposium in Las Vegas. It was a really funny thing because I had the heart attack at the house. My chest was horribly painful, and this all within 10 minutes' time, I finally determined I need to go to ER and find out what was wrong. So I drove myself. It was about 1 o'clock in the morning. I only live about 10 blocks from the hospital.
So, 10 blocks would be like 100 there, blocks.
And within 10 minutes time, the doctor says, well, it looks like we're going to ship you over to the other hospital because you're having a heart attack. I go, heart attack? He goes, yeah. I go, well, am I going to be able to fly Tuesday? He goes, you want to fly Tuesday? I go, yeah, I'm going to Vegas.
Vegas, baby.
And he goes, no, you're not. I'm like, aw.
People have the darkest question to their diet.
Are we talking September 3 months ago?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Wow.
And I'm not broken. No, it was an amazing thing. They drove me over. I took a $1,200 ride from Albany General to Corvallis. Yeah. Trust me. Yeah. They charged $9.22 a mile.
It's $1,000 for that.
Anyway, just so get there.
They can go someplace.
They pull me into. It wasn't ER. Well, they pulled me into an entrance, and I don't even really remember going down a very long hall. They pulled me into this room, and, I mean, just it was amazing. It was just like eight people in there. They start taking your clothes off and stuff. You're like, whoa, wait a minute. And you know, and then they said, don't worry about it. We're going to take care of you. I'm like, well, wait a minute. What are you going to do? And then they explained to me they're going to do an angioplasty.
Right.
I understand what that is. They run a wire up through your veins, up to your heart, find out where the blockage is. And then they have this balloon at the end of it that they inflate, and it opens up your arteries so the blood can flow again.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, they install what's called a stent, and it's a little metal mesh tube that they expand, and it stays open, and it keeps your vein open so that your blood can get oxygen, or your heart can get oxygenated blood so that it can operate properly. And so, yeah, but they did that all in 20 minutes. And I was
goodness.
Yeah, I mean, amazing. All this happened in like maybe an hour and 10 minutes.
So did you catch the flight to Vegas?
The what?
The flight. Did you get to go to Vegas? I shouldn't say did you get to go. Did you go?
Did you go to Vegas?
To Vegas. Did you go to Vegas?
No, I didn't see any white lights, and I didn't go towards the light.
No, flight.
Did you fly to Vegas?
Oh, Vegas, no. No, I did not go to Vegas. I was.
Can't even hear with headphones on.
Well, no, I'll just say, well, did you go? Now, come on. How many connotations are there? We're talking about life and death, right? Okay. In an ER where they're doing questionable things to you until they explain it to you, you know. And you know, no, I already knew before I even left Albany that I wasn't going to Vegas.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So actually, that day when, because after an angioplasty, you cannot move for 8 hours. You're not supposed to move at all.
Wow.
Yeah.
Why?
And so I'm laying there, and my mom showed up. She goes, well, we have to cancel your hotel. We have to cancel the and all the stuff. And I'm like, okay, well, I can't move, but I'm pretty sure I could dial and talk on the phone. And we both did that together. I still did not get my deposit from the Bally back.
Oh, really?
Yeah, all $77 of it. So,
wow.
I kind of figured that was a lesson learned with Vegas.
You've been through the ringer. Bruce has been through the ringer. It was Marcia and I were talking about it. It's been over a year since my last hip surgery. 2 years since the first one, and MRSA twice, and all that. And And we're all sick. And Eve's had to put up with all of us, you know, through the whole thing. You
That's
poor
right.
You're next, Eve.
No.
I've had my share.
But I'll tell you, what has happened this year to me, or I should say for me, you know, when God changes us, you know, it's not something he does to us, it's something he does for us, because it betters us, you know. One of the things that is different this year for me versus last year is, and, you know, and I think to myself, you know, all these years, I've been in my particular 12-step fellowship like 28 years, and I finally get it, you know what I mean? We get things when we get them, right? I mean,
yes.
It just happens. Learning to... And this has been a journey I've been on for a long time, but it really came to a head this year. Learning about emotional sobriety.
Oh, okay.
Learning that how much Bill Wilson dealt with depression that was not clinical. We thought it was, but it wasn't. It was that he was not emotionally sober. He lived his life. So much of the time, so dependent on other people's behavior to be okay with himself.
And codependent.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, we call it codependency, we call it emotional dependency, whatever buzzword you want to use, you're absolutely correct. And Dr. Ellen Berger, who does our every other Saturday our show, Step by Step Towards Emotional Sobriety, has really been a key factor in my spiritual growth in this area, learning to unhook from emotional dependency on other people in order to be okay with me.
Yeah.
Now, years ago, it was horrible. And I've talked about that in my story before, how horrible it was. You know, if I thought we made plans and you canceled them, I was going to come kill you. You know, I was going to hunt you down. Like the alcoholic, you know, the wife of the alcoholic searching out the bars, right? Trying to find her husband. Mm-hmm. I was going to come find you as my friend, and by God, you're going to explain to me why you didn't show up to go to the beach that day. Well, you never said you were. I said you were. And I was so emotionally dependent, and that's just one example. And then years later, through the process of working the steps, something changed. It was amazing. That didn't happen anymore. But it, like anything that is deep, you know, sometimes remnants of that will hang on. And so I give you an example. Being so much better in that area, Cameron, our oldest, and his wife got married. They were living in McMinnville. We hadn't seen him in some time. And we found out that he had come into town and didn't tell us.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh.
Ooh.
So the emotionally dependent person would have absolutely gone ballistic over that. Because by golly, if you're going to come into town, you're going to contact us and tell, I mean, you know, it's control, right? You're going to come in, you're going to say hello, you're going to, you know. And
we're going to play Yahtzee.
Yeah, that's right. We're going to do everything that you hate because that makes me feel good. And so an interesting thing happened. He was in the mall with his buddies. And Colin, his younger brother, saw him there.
Did he approach him?
No, but he called me.
He ratted out his big brother.
Cameron's in town. Yeah. Did you know?
So Cameron sees this happening, runs up to him. Put that phone down. Put him up. So then Cameron's friends rat him out. In the back right here, Cameron's in town. And like, something happened, though. It was really interesting. There was a little sting there, but as fast as it came, it went away.
Mm.
And I was like, this is okay.
Yeah.
This is fine. You know, he hasn't been away from his new bride in all these weeks. He's finally getting to hook up with his buddies. Last thing he wants to do is come by and see mom and dad. I remember those days. when I was in college and wanted to come home, but I didn't want to stop by the house.
We raise them. It's called emotional health. Yeah, that's actually what we want for our children.
Yeah, we raise them to be independent.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
Right. So
my oldest is very independent.
So as fast as this thing came, it went away, and it was all right.
Mm-hmm.
It was all right. Yeah. And he didn't have to hear me calling him up saying, why didn't you come by or any of that kind of stuff. I just left it alone.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something God has done for me, because that is not my nature. You know, my nature is to be controlling, manipulative. You know, I want my way. I want to feel good about who I am. And that's dependent on how you feel about me. Well, mm-hmm. Thank God that's not the truth. I might feel that way sometimes, but the truth of the matter is my dependency is totally 100% dependent on what God thinks about me, which he sees me through the eyes of his son, which this holiday is all about. And we could argue about, okay, was Jesus born on in December or not? You know, here's my take on that. If you throw me a surprise birthday party, my birthday is in October, and you throw me a surprise birthday party in February, I'm probably not going to complain. You know?
I would.
You would.
Not so much a surprise anymore, Monty.
Yeah, because then it would really be a surprise.
Every year on the 25th. I can't believe it. They couldn't have picked a better time of year.
If somebody threw me a surprise party in February, my birthday's also in October. Well, that would just tear me up.
Well, then you need... You need a lesson in emotional sobriety.
Which was 5 months after the fact that they finally remembered, oh, man, his birthday was in October. Quick, put together a party, we'll surprise him.
I know. But, you know, we have celebrations.
No, maybe we just ding a little.
We have celebrations for all sorts of things that none of us here identify with. But we respect that, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, there's Hanukkah, there's Kwanzaa. There's this day for that. There's that day for this. Kids are out of school because of weird stuff. I mean,
don't forget Boxing Day.
Boxing Day. Yeah.
That's when all the boxers come out and give presents to the needy.
Underwear? Yeah.
No, they box. They box.
You said boxers.
No, boxers. You know the guys.
Oh,
punch each
boxers!
Other.
I just said it was Boxer Day. Like everybody was supposed to wear boxers or something.
No, well, I see. Don't confuse them with the Packers. Okay.
You know, I was listening to you when you was talking earlier, and you were saying, that's my nature, that's who I am.
Mm-hmm.
And in the flesh, that is.
Flesh.
And I think that one of the most wonderful things that I've learned this year is I can't change those things. That's who I am. I might not like them.
Yeah.
You know? Or I might like them, but I mean, that's who I am. That's my nature.
Mm.
You know? And that's what drove me to God.
Mm. Your inability to change those things?
Yeah. And now, and you said it, Monty, and for those that know what we're talking about, I'm cloaked with his righteousness. And now I'm just trying to live out of that positional truth, you see.
Right.
And because I can't change this. So I'm learning how to walk and be the light, and, you know. And live out of what he's done for me.
Right.
Not what I'm going to get. But, see, it's all accomplished. We just have to learn to receive it.
Well, no, I'll have to agree with that, because I think in the last 3 years, a change has come over me. And I can't say that I've consciously made a concerted effort to do this. But I've found that I've calmed down quite a bit. I don't... Mm. This emotional sobriety you're talking about, mm-hmm. I don't get caught up emotionally in everything, every little thing that happens in the world.
Right.
You know, like, no, I'm not going to bring that up. But
hey, we don't want to get caught
things
up.
Things that happen in the media, things that happen in social media, things that happen globally. That people get so outraged about
that they can't change anyway, right?
And it's like, well, you know what? I cannot affect any kind of effect on it at all. So why am I even expending all this emotional energy when I can just be a spectator? I can check in with myself and say, do I even need to be, you know, invest that much emotionally into a given situation? And I find out most of the time that, no, I don't need to make an emotional investment at all.
Right.
I can be an observer, and I can express an opinion.
You can pray about it.
Getting that. And my first thing that I can actually do to even try it cause some kind of effect in a situation is to pray.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're directed to do right off the bat. It's our first course of action is to pray. And I've been learning that, well, you know what, that is the case. In fact, I've been included on a call list at my church, you know, and, cool. You know, this is happening. You know, I get an alert on my phone, you know, this is so-and-so is needing prayer, blah, 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 blah. Okay, well, bam, boom, I stop, I pray, you know, and I do my best to remember to pray more than once about it.
Right.
You know, I don't just send God a memo and expect him to remember, you know. So, but no, I understand this whole calming down thing. I haven't calmed down completely.
But it's better than it was.
Oh, it's much better than
me
it
too,
was.
Me too, man. Me too. And let me just say this, and we got to go to a break, and then we got to wrap it up. Let me just say this. I've noticed it in my Facebook posts. I am not responding as much as I used to things that get me riled up.
The haters.
Yeah.
Those who have to oppose you immediately.
Right. And so I start sometimes, and then I go, why?
Backspace.
Exactly.
My favorite button on the keyboard now.
Sometimes backspace and delete can be the greatest gift you have.
Boy, I'm glad I never got involved with that. Mm-mm. You know, and I don't even have a cell phone.
Bruce
is not owned by technology.
One of the things Dr. Berger says, and we did this show last Saturday called 12 Stupid Things to Mess Up the Holidays. One of those things is to point at, because your relatives and loved ones will give you ample opportunity to do this, to point out all their character defects. Right. And then he said that's one of the stupid things you can do to mess up the holidays. He said, so learn to keep quiet, particularly when you know you're right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes that can be a real gift.
Yeah.
To do that. Is you really bet. Worth it?
You bet.
Hey, listen, we got to take.
Unless you're really up for a good debate.
That's right. We're going to take a short break. When we come back, we're going to listen to this song called Just a Girl by Brandon Heath. Before we do that, though, we're gonna talk a little bit about what Linus said in A Charlie Brown Christmas. Don't go away.
My baby boy was a very good sleeper. He would nap in the morning and nap again in the afternoon, so my routine became that I would drink the first half of the time I expected him to sleep so that I could pass out the second half. Even during my pregnancy, knowing that it might be harmful to the baby, I could not stop drinking. The fear of any harm to that child was not enough to make me stop. Sometimes I would try to go to the park with him, but I was becoming really fearful of people finding out what a sick person I was. Today, since I joined AA, I don't have that sensation anymore at all. I have a purpose in life today. I know who I am. I know where I'm going, and I feel good about it. I can be a mother to my child, and I can be a wife to my husband, and I couldn't be any of those things when I was drinking. Alcoholics Anonymous, it works. Look us up. Check your phone book, newspaper, or AA.org.
Pardon me. Dude, are you in the rooms?
Bro, I've been going to meetings for years.
Yeah, but dude, are you in the rooms?
Bro, I'm in meetings all the time. Of course I'm in the rooms.
Yeah, but are you registered on in the rooms?
Bro, you're not making any sense.
Dude, pay attention. I'm talking about intherooms.com. It's only the world's largest online recovery social networking site for recovery folks like you and me, dude, or anyone seeking help from any addiction. You get exclusive free access to daily meditations, speaker tapes, and daily online video AA and NA meetings, dude. There are close to 300,000 members who are willing to share their experience, strength, and hope with you, dude.
With me?
Yeah, with you. Here's what you do.
What's that?
Get on your computer, your smartphone or your tablet and type in www.intherooms.com. It's for fun and for free, dude. Dude, what are you doing?
Well, I just did what you said. Now, I'm in the rooms.
Dude, bro, we're both in the rooms.
Dude, bro, yeah.
Dude, yeah.
Yeah, dude. Hey, bro, I'm hungry. Are you in the pizza?
Dude. Oh, dude.
In the Rooms, the world's largest recovery social networking site with something for everybody. Visit www.intherooms.com and register for free.
This is Chris Schroeder. You are listening to Take12Radio.com, recovery talk and positive music.
All right, and we have returned, and this is our Christmas special, and Wado is here, and Bruce and Eve, and we've been talking about what's maybe a little different this year. And it sounds to me like we've all grown, we've all matured, and we've gone through some...
I wouldn't say I've, like, matured.
Okay, we've grown and matured, and you've just gotten your hair longer.
You know.
Hey, I want to tell you guys, I saw a picture of Wade when in his younger days.
Oh, my gosh. Which one?
I think you're leaning against a tree or something.
Oh, right, yeah.
This guy, if I may say so, was quite the stunning young man. He was a rock star.
I don't know what happened.
What happened, man?
I got married. I had kids. I became a responsible adult. Then I got in recovery.
I want to make sure that we thank everybody that has been a part of Take 12 Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting this year. We've had some amazing people come alongside of us, donate and support us, and I don't have time to mention everybody. Some of them will be on the credits on the YouTube video, but thank you so much. And you guys, Wade is always quick to say, yeah, absolutely. If I call him up and say, I need a disclaimer done, I need a voiceover done.
I love doing that.
Yeah, he's here in a snap. And Bruce and Eve, you guys have been here. It's funny because I wrote in Bruce's card or something. I said, so much for a six-month commitment. Because we had talked originally about, let's just do this for 6 months and see how it goes. And when 6 months came, I just didn't say anything.
Yeah, it is funny because that's what he said to Sheree and I. And it was like 3.5 years later, and it was like, Monty,
if he's got anything, it's a good zipper.
It's coming up on 2 years, isn't it?
Coming up on 2 years, yeah. Yeah, pretty soon.
I think in March or April.
I don't know.
I don't remember what month we started, but yeah. It was early in the
April.
Year. So yeah. I think you're right. I think you're right. We'll have to have a cake.
I'll be here.
No frosting.
Well, listen.
I'll bring my roasted vegetables.
That's right.
Good guy.
Well, listen, in a
diabetics and vegetarians and oh my God.
I know. Okay. We're just sick. One of the most endearing cartoons ever. And it doesn't seem to matter what faith you are or what you believe or don't believe. Everybody loves a Charlie Brown Christmas. And Charles Schultz was a friend of mine. Mm. He lived in Sebastopol, right down the street from where we lived. And the world lost an amazing man. In a cartoonist as well as a very spiritual and in touch gentleman years ago. And his TV show that plays every year, A Charlie Brown Christmas, is full of laughter and fun and all that. But there is a point in the Charlie Brown Christmas TV special.
I've never seen it.
You've never seen it? You have got to see it.
Really? That I own the soundtrack. That's Christmas music to me because that's what I grew up with.
Mm. Yeah, fact, Vince Guaraldi.
Cecil was playing Vince Guaraldi Trio while reading
that's right.
that whole political correct.
Yeah, that's what was in the background. Vince Guaraldi Trio. Yeah, you bet. And but at one point in the television show, there's a serious moment, And all the Peanuts characters are talking back and forth, what's Christmas all about? And Charlie Brown says, what is Christmas all about? And it gets real silent. The lights go down. The spotlight goes on Linus.
That's because he goes, lights, please.
Lights, please. Yeah. And Linus reads from the Gospels.
He recites it, Monty.
He recites it, yeah.
Right off the top of his head.
Right.
Because he's a brainiac.
Yeah, because he is. And he tells the Christmas story. And one of my favorite parts that he says, and the shepherds saw the light, and they were sore afraid. You know, it's just that you, that little kid, you mm-hmm. know. We saw a Christmas special on Sunday, and one of the shepherds had a lisp. Yeah. And I loved it. Mm-hmm. It was awesome. And he talks about the birth of our Savior. And at the end of that, he said, and that's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown. We talk a lot in the world today. Christmas is about giving. Christmas is about family. Christmas is about this. What Christmas is not about, the commercialization. You know, listen, the commercialization happens all year round. We just get Christmas music attached to it with some lights, but it's going on all the time.
The Christmas music starts in the second week of September.
Yeah, I know. But here, you know, we, even if you are not of the same faith, you can't deny the fact that this is what this holiday is about, even if you don't agree with it. It's like the big book. You don't have to agree with what it says, but you got to admit that it says what it says, right? So being a faith-based radio station, and we're all-inclusive in all of our shows, this is the one show, the Wednesday show, where we are very Christ-specific, and we make no apologies for that. The other shows, not so much all the time. But that is really what is going on. I mean, you know, God, I mean, how can you be afraid of a little baby, for crying out loud? You know what I'm saying? God came in the form of a man and did an amazing thing. And one of the people in that story that I think gets kind of the short end of the stick sometimes is his mom. Mm. You know,
Well, I don't know. The Catholics revere.
They do.
Mary. Mother Mary, yeah.
And I think sometimes us Protestants, we kind of lose that a little bit sometimes. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to play this song. This is by Brandon Heath, one of my favorite artists. This is called Just a Girl. And we're going to close out with this song by Brandon Heath. Check it out.
Heard the story, little fame and lesser glory, night the keeper of the inn, the little town of Bethlehem, encountered Joseph and his Mary, about to birth the Savior of the world. His wife said, go and see who's knocking. He ran down to the gate, unlocked it. The moment he heard Mary's cry, couldn't look them in the eye. Tonight the men went back to bed. When his wife asked who was there, he said, I don't know. Just a girl, just a couple gypsies begging at the door. Told them we don't have room for any more. And close a girl. He tried to sleep, he wasn't able. He snuck out to the dirty stable. Two had found for covering, and later in her suffering, the keeper knelt outside the barn. And in the light of that great star, he prayed, what have I done? He's just a babe. Minutes old, they're trembling in the hay. I could have found a room for them to stay. I'm so ashamed. He's just a babe. There was no road. There was no road. Just a million angels crowding in to see Jesus there among humanity. Just a babe, just a minute soul there trembling in the hay, staring at his mother in the face. She's just a girl, just a girl. Does she even know that she just changed the world? Does she even know that he will save the world? Does Mary know that he will save the world?
Just a girl, Brandon Heath. Okay, we have just a few seconds left. Any last words from you guys? Yeah,
good night, Cecil.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
Waito.
Nappy Who Year, and you know.
Nappy.
Yeah. You know, I like to play with words. Merry Christmas, everyone.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
And by the way, this has been a broadcast of KHLC Recovery Broadcasting.